Okay, well, thanks everybody for coming. As it says on the screen here, this is OWASP Broken Web Applications Beyond 1.0. So thank you all for coming. And I want to make this kind of an interactive presentation as far as I want to talk to you guys a little bit, because really the goal of this is to make sure that people kind of understand what the project is and where we're at and also where I kind of see it going. But I'm really trying to gather some feedback from people as far as kind of what you would like to see going forward as well. So definitely feel free to chime in if you've got questions or comments or anything, or talk to me afterwards, or reach out in other ways, because that's really what I'm trying to do here is figure out, what is the next step for this project. So just a quick agenda of what we're going to do today. So we're going to start by doing some introductions and then talk about a little bit of background on the project if you're not familiar with it, where we're at currently, and then, as the title mentions, talk a little bit about the future as well, where it's going and where it could be going, I guess, as well, depending on what you guys are interested in. And we've got some, time for Q&A at the end, but we're happy to take questions during the presentation as well. So just throw your hand up if you got anything. So just a quick about me. So I work for Mandiant in the D.C. area. So a lot of people know us for our incident response services and managed services and products and things like that. But we also do application security and penetration testing and stuff. So that's really my focus at the company and in general. So that's kind of doing that kind of work is really what brought me to start the OWASP Broken Web Applications project. And I've led it since its inception. If you want to follow me on Twitter or email me, my information is there. So I want to hear a little bit about you guys as well. So curious to know just who all has seen a presentation about the Broken Web Applications project before. So either in person or on a video or something like that, a webinar. So only a couple people. So assuming that people actually raise their hands if the answer is correct. So that's why I'll give a little bit of background here on the project and do some demos and stuff as well. So if you haven't seen it at all before, this will kind of get you started as well. Because I want to make sure that we're kind of covering the bases, I guess. So a little bit about the background for the project. So it started in 2008, 2009 kind of time frame. And I was looking for web applications where I could do a variety of things. One of the main things was just kind of testing tools and manual techniques and, both dynamic testing tools and source code analysis tools. Because I wanted to know, have a kind of a standard test bed to say, okay, does this tool find this sort of issue? Are there kind of extenuating circumstances maybe that would cause it to not find the issue? Or, are there better ways that you can detect or exploit things manually as well? So that was kind of one of my main motivations. Another was really because at the time I was really interested in source code analysis and doing some kind of research in that area. So I wanted to look at the actual code that implements a specific vulnerabilities in order to say, how does that look? And how could I also modify the code to fix it? So kind of here's the broken thing, and now let's fix it. Let's look at a fixed version. How do they compare? And come up with ways maybe you could differentiate between the two if you were doing some sort of analysis. And also to do a couple other things later on was, testing web application firewalls or examining evidence left by attackers were kind of other use cases that I came up with later once kind of the project had started. But I think they're also pretty valid. Actually, one of my motivations was the last time that, I believe it was the last time that the AppSec conference was here in the New York area, there was a presentation about using mod security to protect WebGoat, which if you've worked with WebGoat at all, it's a great training environment, but it's not a real application, and it's got a lot of behaviors that are not typical of a normal application. And so I kind of thought that, well, you really need a better test bed for evaluating something like a web application firewall than WebGoat. So I thought it was appropriate that OWASP would come up with another solution, which is ultimately what we did. So as I mentioned, WebGoat was one of the common things that people thought of when I first was kind of asking around, like, hey, does something like this already exist? And as I mentioned, it's a great learning tool, but it's not a real application. It's a training environment. It's designed to kind of walk you through this is a SQL injection, and this is a cross-site scripting, and gives you hints and things like that. There's ways you can, like, view the source code within the application, which is great for training, but it's not, at all what a real application would do. So it's again, it's useful for certain things, but not really for everything that I wanted to do. And the same was true of kind of other training applications that were out there. There are others besides WebGoat. There weren't a lot at that time in the time frame when I was kind of starting this project, but there's been more that have kind of popped up since there. But a lot of them have those same kind of issues, which is that anything that's really designed for training is not going to be look like a real application for either any sort of automated testing or doing any sort of like training for even for manual penetration testing and things like that. So I looked around a little bit more, and at the time, if you wanted to kind of find a realistic application that had intentional vulnerabilities, there weren't really any open source ones out there. What was available was things like Foundstone's Hackme Bank and Hackme Casino and other their series, which were pretty useful because they look like real applications, but they had a lot of vulnerabilities. But unfortunately, they were closed source, so you couldn't do any of the kind of source code analysis or use it really for developer training very easily. A lot of them ran on the Windows platform, so it wasn't easy to have a VM that you can distribute in that. Some of them that didn't run on Windows, I'm sorry, some ran on Windows, some didn't as well, so you had issues where you couldn't really create kind of a monolithic VM to include everything because they had all these different platforms and backends that they required, along with licensing restrictions, not only for the OS, but also for the applications themselves. They weren't open in the OWASP sense. So that didn't really fit the need for what I was looking for. So we started the OWASP Broken Web Applications project. So what the project does is it creates a free Linux-based virtual machine, contains a variety of web applications, some of which are intentionally broken, some of which are old versions of open source applications. So we'll show some of those in some demos here in a little bit. And everything's really just kind of pre-configured, ready to use. So in theory, you could do this by just kind of assembling some open source applications and throwing them onto a VM yourself. But in practice, it becomes difficult sometimes to actually get them all to play nicely with each other. Some of them kind of assume that they're the only thing running on a VM at a time or on a system at a time. So you've got to adjust some things if you want to run them, for example, in a subdirectory like we do for the BWA VM. So, and not only that, but we've also actually created, for example, user accounts and put some data into the applications as well that I'll show in some demos. So it's really, once you kind of start it up, you're ready to just get started with testing. You don't need to do a lot of configuration in that. And, in the kind of typical OWASP sense, it's, everything's open source. Means you can modify it, both the project as a whole or mess with individual applications. You can, it's great for developer training because all the source code is there. And as much as possible, we have the build environments available as well. So you can look at the code that implements the vulnerability, potentially fix them, look at the modified code and things like that. So I asked earlier kind of who had seen a copy of the or a presentation about this. Who's actually played with the BWA VM as far as downloaded it, ran it, some? So again, just a couple people. So a couple more than I had seen presentations. But what I'm going to do here is really just kind of start, I think, with some demos here after we talk about the history. So as I mentioned, the first version came out in 2009, the initial release anyway. Took a while before we actually hit the 1.0 last year, although it was kind of an arbitrary number, but I kind of felt like at some point we had to have a 1.0 release in order to kind of get it out of beta stage. So that's been about a year ago now. The current version, I've had a couple little bug fixes in the last few months. There's a couple more issues that will be fixed soon, as we'll talk about in the future section. But the key here is just, OWASPBWA.org is the website where you'll be able to, all that does is redirect to the specific page on the OWASP wiki. So you can certainly just Google OWASPBWA as well and probably come up with it. But that's where you can download the VM. That's where you can pull down the, look at the user guide and other things like that as well. So let's talk a little bit more about the details here, actually, before we jump into a demo. So the first thing is it is a virtual machine, so it's something you download. It's available now in two different formats. The most long-lived format has been just a VMware format, so it's in the VMware virtual machine format. And it specifically uses an older version of the VMware format, so you can use it in both the no-cost and the commercial products from VMware. It'll run on like an ESX server if you want to put it in more like a lab-type environment on a server as opposed to on a workstation or on an individual desktop. But you can also import the virtual disks into VirtualBox or Parallels, and more recently we started releasing the VM as a .ova file as well, which is basically an open virtualization archive. So if you download the VM, it's about a gig and a half, more or less, depending on what format you download it in, because the OVA file format is the largest, but it's the easiest to use probably in non-VMware products. But then we also released it in both 7-zip and regular zip formats as well, just to make it smaller for people that need to download, especially if you're somewhere with low bandwidth. And recently we've also started releasing it in through BitTorrent as well. So It's I haven't had a lot of people using that yet to really give me feedback as to how great it is, as far as, because we're using a project that basically kind of pulls in stuff from the web download sites in order to kind of assemble a BitTorrent download. So like I said, let's just go ahead and get started with a couple demos just to break it up here a little bit. So when you download the VM, this is what you're going to see if this is in VMware Workstation, but it'll look very similar in any other project. The VM ships without any snapshots or anything, again, just making it very compatible with other products. I always recommend that the first thing you should do is create a snapshot of your VM, and that's supported in, I don't know if VMware Player supports it now in the free version, but I know that Workstation will, or VirtualBox. You can create a snapshot, so that way you can always revert the VM back to the original state that the thing was in, because that kind of gives you freedom to break things if you want. And like I said, it's a big download and that. By default, it comes with, I think, 1 gigabyte of RAM allocated. I just added it a little bit here. But also in the description, you'll see that it has the root password, the login, root, and then the OWASP BWA is the password. As I mentioned, this is the compatibility. It's using deliberately an old version of the VM format. So when you start the thing up, you're going to get a basically an old school kind of Linux boot up sequence. So there's no I've kind of turned off the stuff that normally hides all this junk from you in more modern Linux systems. And once it comes up, what you're going to get is just basically a text login prompt. So the idea here is there's no X windows, there's no GUI. We've specifically kind of bounded the project to only talk cover the targets as far as the vulnerable web applications that you would have. So there's nothing on here that's a tool that you would use to assess the applications or any sort of hacking tools or anything like that. Feel that that's kind of best split off as a separate effort. So for example, OWASP has their live CD, which is also available as a VM as well, that gives you some of those attacking tools. They might include some of the same targets. I think like WebGoat might be on there as well on the live CD. But a lot of times what I recommend to people is they just use Kali or Backtrack kind of a VM that, or potentially just kind of set up things on your host. For web testing, you usually don't need a whole lot of tools. A lot of it can be done just with something like Zap and a web browser and maybe a couple other minor tools. So yeah, so once the machine boots up, you're going to see this kind of message here. It gives you the IP address that the machine has been assigned. That way you can know what to browse to. And gives you the username and password again, gives you the version of the VM if you have various ones floating around, and then also how you can manage it. One of the things I always recommend to people, though, is that you kind of take this IP address here and put it into your host file on whatever machine you're kind of using for attacks. And just set the OWASP BWA as the host name, because that'll just make it a little bit easier to get to things, and it'll also allow you to more easily use vulnerabilities that are reported by other people, because they'll usually use that OWASP BWA as the host name. So you'll see that in some of the demos here. So, and then also as shown on that first screen, you can SSH into the box. You can also mount some Samba shares, or there's PHP MyAdmin for administering the databases if you need to connect to those. So even though PHP MyAdmin is on there, it's not intended to be one of the vulnerable web applications. And we're based on a pretty old version of Ubuntu at this point in 10.04. Probably not going to upgrade it because as soon as we do, I think we're going to break some of the old open source applications that we have. So that's one of the things we'll kind of talk about looking forward in the future, is how to deal with that. So underneath the hood, as far as the main software that you have running the applications, it's your kind of standard stack is the primary things that are used. So Apache, PHP, MySQL. There's also Tomcat and some Python and some Ruby stuff that's exposed all through the same main web interface through the main Apache web server using mod proxy. So if you do start digging around under the hood, you'll see there's some other ports that are open that are exposed through mod proxy, basically to allow people to access them, because for reasons we'll talk about in a little bit later, I guess. There's also, as I mentioned, the developer tools, like the OpenJDK is on there. So not only can you run Java applications, but you can also build them. So if developer type training, if you want to modify some of the Java code and see what happens when you make changes to it, you can do that. And Mono is also running on there, so that gives you the ability to run ASP.NET code. So It's a little bit difficult to run kind of arbitrary ASP.NET stuff because a lot of times it requires a Microsoft SQL backend, but you can run things that are kind of specially designed for running in a mono environment or maybe something that doesn't require a database. So we've got a couple little example applications in there that we can show in a little bit as well. And more recently, we've added Ruby and specifically Rails applications as well, so that's in there. So it gives you kind of a variety of different platforms. And when I talk about the applications, you'll see kind of which ones are used more than others. There's also some other things behind the scenes. So a lot of the applications are actually on the VM are pulled directly from the source code repositories for the open source applications. So we use Subversion and Git to do that. So there's a basically allows us to more easily kind of update things as appropriate when we're coming out with new versions of the VM. But there's ways you could go in there yourself and do that as well, along with some scripts to help you out. As I mentioned, there is a there's a Postgres database that's running as well. It's not actually used by any of the applications yet. That's something I'd like to get an application, at least one application touching that. But it is there, and I think it does run by default just for the case that we'll eventually need it. Also, mod security is running. By default, there's no rules set up, so it's not actually doing anything, but it is there so that you could create some rules yourself, or there's the core rule set is installed on the machine but just kind of not enabled, so there's a way that you can enable those as well in order to kind of see, so if you're not familiar with mod security, it's an open source web application firewall. The core rule set is an open OWASP-supported rule set of things basically within mod security. So if you want to know, what sort of attacks are blocked by that, how could you perhaps get around those sorts of attacks, that's what the core rule set will allow you to do. And there's some custom scripts that we can talk about in a bit, too. So I'm just going to jump back over to my demo here and talk about some of the applications that you have. So as you see here, once you've booted this up, there's really not anything here because there's no, as I mentioned, no GUI, no web browser or anything. So what you need to do is just connect to this machine remotely. So for my example here, let me get my cursor back. So I'm just going to fire up Firefox, and I'll go to the, again, I've got just my homepage already set as the OWASP BWA website, but you, like I said, if you didn't have that set up, you could just put in the IP address that was shown on that previous screen. So what you see once you go to that through your web browser is just a little bit of information about the project at the top, link to the homepage for it, for the OWASP homepage, and the user guide, which is also useful. If you do have any questions, definitely take a look at that as well. It's not perfect, but there is something there, and we're always trying to make it better. And also a big caveat here about this, the VM obviously has a ton of security issues along with having SSH and other things exposed with commonly known passwords. So don't recommend that you run this on within any sort of network where you're worried about other people messing with it. So typically run it in like a NAT type mode so just you can access it, or perhaps in a lab environment or something like that. So just be aware now. No, reality, there's nothing sensitive on the machine either, but someone could use it to maybe bounce through it to do other things. So what we've got here in the applications is really three primary sets of types of applications that I'll talk about, along with a few kind of other miscellaneous things at the bottom. So the first set of applications is what we call training applications. So training applications are things that kind of, as like WebGoat, if you've worked with that, I talked about earlier. And actually, there's a tooltip here that's telling us that if they're designed for learning, they guide the user to specific vulnerabilities. So it's going to tell you, like, okay, you're going to have a SQL injection on this page, and if you want to get a hint, it'll tell you more about how to exploit the SQL injection and what SQL injection is and things like that. So it's a great place to start if you're just kind of learning about this, or if you're trying to get other people to learn about it, web application security. You can point them towards these training applications. But again, they're not structured like a real application. So one thing that's not always obvious on this is that if you click on the little green plus here, you'll get some more information about each of these applications. So when you get that more information, you're going to see the version. So in some cases, it'll say, plus SVN or plus Git, meaning that we're basically pulling that directly from their source code repository, and it may actually be newer than the version number that's listed because they may not have had a release with kind of the full set of features that we've pulled in. The language it's written in, and then also important is, as I mentioned earlier, we create user accounts on these different applications in order to just kind of make it easier for people to get started. So wherever possible, we try to use, you know, guest or admin user as kind of the credentials. But sometimes we kind of use whatever they've already got set up. Also here, you'll have a link to the homepage for that specific one. So in this case, it would take you to like the WebGoat project homepage. Because that can be useful for some of these applications where they've got their own documentation or their own kind of details about how to get started with it, maybe some how-to videos and things like that, that you can go to their homepage and visit that and be able to make use of what they've already provided. So, and then if you wanted to go to a particular application, then you just click on the link. So what I'm gonna show is OWASP Utility. Is anybody here familiar with that project, the Utility project? No? Okay. Well, it's good. That's why I like to show it, because a lot of people have heard of WebGoat and maybe messed with it. Honestly, it hasn't been updated in a while, so it's getting a little bit old. And so Utility is very frequently being updated, and I think it's a great place to kind of start with these. So as I mentioned, when you click on this to display it, you'll see the credentials. So here we know that user is password that we can use. So we click on this application, and then, you know, behind the scenes what's happening is that it's just going to the subdirectory within the BWA VM where that application happens to be running. And as I mentioned earlier, that some of the applications that are running on, you know, Java, for example, will, you know, it's still kind of seamless as far as it looks like you're just going to a directory, but in reality it's going through mod proxy to connect to the Tomcat server, for example. So Utility is an application that's got a lot of features in there. It can be a lot to kind of look at from the beginning, but the gist of kind of the most important things there are this navigation on the left, where it allows you to go through and see different sorts of issues. So the main way that I normally look at it is through the OWASP top 10 view. So if you click on you mouse over that, you'll see a list of the OWASP top 10. I'm not sure if this is, I think this is the probably 2010 version. I don't know if they've updated it for 2013 yet, because it looks like A9 is different. You'll have, in this case, they've actually broke out A1 into a couple different things because it's got a lot of injection stuff. So would you say that? So say, okay, I want to learn about SQL injection, and then it'll have several different, you know, different types of SQL injection, and then it'll have it gets a little bit confusing. So then because I'm running out of screen real estate, it's actually pulling back over to here where it says user info. So that's basically a page that is vulnerable to SQL injection where you can extract some data. So when I click on this page, it's going to take me here and say, okay, well, this is a page where if I wanted to, I can just log in with my credentials that we have from the previous. I'm trying not to show you the hints since that's kind of a bit of a distraction. So I can log in there and it'll show me some data, but I also know that it's vulnerable to SQL injection because they've told me that. So if I mouse over one of these fields, it gives me a little bit of generic information about, you know, SQL injection may occur, kind of thing. That's what it calls pop-up hints that I think are on by default. So you can hide those if you want by clicking that to get rid of those. But now I can, you know, click here without bothering with that. But you also have another thing just called I don't know what it's just regular hints, I suppose, where that's what this, when you turn on the hints, you'll get on these pages a kind of bar here that you can expand that talks about hints for the different sorts of issues that are on this page. And you see, the way Utility works is it's got a relatively small selection of different pages, but then a lot of those pages have multiple different issues on them. So here it's showing you that this one page has, you know, four different issues. And if you want information about any one of those, you can then click on that to get information about SQL injection. So here it's talking about kind of SQL injection in general and how to exploit it, and then, you know, how to run SQL mapped if you wanted to actually, once you found it. And here's some more specific stuff. So it really does walk you through a lot of the details about how to use the different tools in order to find and exploit SQL injection. So That's the kind of things that you'll find on Utility. Another nice thing about it is that it includes a couple different security levels. So by default, there's kind of no security enabled. But you can turn on a little bit of security where it's doing some kind of some basic kind of blacklisting of certain types of things. So for example, for SQL injection, maybe it's going to look for or 1 = 1 kind of strings and strip those out. but you could probably use, you know, OR 5 equals 5 and allow you to get through. You can also do kind of the level 5 is where they believe that they've fixed all the vulnerabilities. So in this case, I don't know if it's doing parameterized queries or if it's doing some pretty strict input validation, but for whatever reason, they believe that there's no vulnerabilities here anymore. Which is kind of a good challenge, because if you can actually find vulnerabilities when you're on level 5, I'm sure the developers would love to hear about that, because it'd be something good for them to you know, fix in their application and maybe talk about in their help in that as well. So in addition to its kind of just normal web pages, it's got web services, both SOAP and REST-based, HTML5 stuff. There's just really a bunch of stuff that they have that's really interesting, I think. So this is always the kind of number one application that I tell people to look at as far as if they're in a kind of a training mode, especially if they have somebody who's messed with WebGoat a little bit and is kind of wants to try something else. So there's some other, what I try to do on these pages is, you know, kind of highlight the OWASP projects at the top. So there's also the webgoat.net, which is kind of a newer project that has some .NET functionality as far as kind of a webgoat type interface, as far as the training application. There's an ESAPI example application. We've got RailsGoat, which is kind of like webgoat, but for Rails. Brix is another thing. So there's a lot of different kind of training applications here to really kind of suit, you know, different use cases. So for example, RailsGoat obviously is on Ruby on Rails. So if you're doing developer training for like Rails developers, that's a good place to start. So that's really what the training applications look like. The next set of applications is what we call realistic but intentionally vulnerable applications. So these are applications where they look like a real application, but they've got all sorts of vulnerabilities in them. So a couple of kind of common ones there is that, you know, VicNoom is a PHP in Perl. It's an OWASP project that has a couple different games that are in it where you can go and do like guess the number or guess a word kind of games. And so there's some interesting stuff you can do here as far as looking at the traffic going on behind the scenes and that. But the idea here is when you're playing it anyway, you know, if you just, so I'm just going to put my name in and click play. And so it's trying to say, you know, I think it's a 3-digit number that you're trying to guess. And so as I'm doing this, it's not telling me at all, you know, here's something where you could put in SQL injection, or this is where you might want to put in some cross-site scripting kind of attacks. It looks like a real application in the sense of you've got to go and try to find the vulnerabilities there, which I think pretty useful. In this case, it's you know, this is Perl actually that's doing the back end part, which is also kind of interesting since you know, it's less common to have these kind of vulnerable applications that are in Perl. We've got a lot of PHP stuff in general. So for example, Wacko Pico here is a file sharing, or I'm sorry, like a picture sharing kind of site. So it allows you to, you know, upload pictures and look at you know, assign things as far as a guest book, that sort of thing. Perugia is a similar one. Bodget is like an actual store. Bodget's kind of interesting. I've seen several people kind of using that for demos here because it's written in Java, JSP. So if you're dealing with like enterprise type customers or doing like developer training for enterprise developers, a lot of times they're not going to use PHP or Perl. They're going to be using Java. So this is a good application that you can use to kind of demonstrate some Java issues. It's all JSP though. It's not compiled Java, but you can see that here. And also, I mentioned RailsGoat earlier as a Ruby on Rails application. We've also got another Ruby on Rails application that's called Cyclone. I can open up real quick, and it's basically a financial type application where you're like transferring money between different users. But again, this is an application that doesn't look like it looks like a real application. It's not artificial in any way. So it's a great way to kind of, again, if you're doing Rails training, or Rails developer training, you can do that. And sometimes you will run into some of these issues where, as it's spinning up like Rails, for example, the VM may time out, so it'll give me a chance, it'll start up again. You can see it actually pull up the title bar. Yeah. So this is the, and this gives you, you know, username and password you can use to log in and do some stuff. So The key here is, most of these applications are available elsewhere in some form or fashion anyway. There's a couple kind of minor things that are, primarily available through this VM. But really the gist that we've done here in the Broken Web Apps project is really to pull everything together and put it into one package. So the last flavor of applications that we have is really just open source applications. So these are just old versions of open source applications that have security vulnerabilities. So for example, we've got WordPress version 2.0.0 from late 2005. And not only do we have it installed, but again, we've got user accounts created, some blog entries created, and some plugins that we know have vulnerabilities as well kind of set up and installed for you. So this is really, I think, a great kind of next step. So if you think of someone who's kind of going through a training type cycle, they start out with the training applications to kind of understand the basics of the issues. They move on to the realistic-looking applications that are still kind of shooting fish in the barrel in the sense that there's vulnerabilities all over the place. You move on to these sort of applications where these are developers are trying to do things right and just had some issues here and there, but they're not near as many of them as there are in the earlier applications. So it's a good kind of next step. So this WordPress is PHP, but there's also some other PHP stuff. Yaz, I know, is a Java application, again, so good for developer training. Yaz is actually compiled Java, which is nice. So if you've got people that want to, we've got scripts to let you rebuild that application when you redo it and that. What we don't have here, I'm just realizing, is we don't have, descriptions of some of these, but Yaz is it's a forum. It's like a discussion forum kind of application. And then the last couple things we have are there's a few tools here that are designed specifically for testing, like automated source code tools and that. So a couple folks have created kind of test beds to use for doing benchmarking of different, actually not so much source code analysis tools, but dynamic analysis tools. So we've got those on here that you can mess with. You can mess with them manually as well, but some of them are a little bit. There's not really normal navigation. It's a little bit confusing sometimes to understand how to use them if you're not just pointing a scanner at it. Along with some example stuff, so I mentioned we have ASP.NET, so I've just created a simple ASP.NET form with cross-site scripting on it so that you can just see that you can actually run ASPX files as an example. There's also a very simple, again, just with cross-site scripting issues, Struts form that allows you to just show that Apache Struts applications you could put on here as well. So those are just really kind of proof of concepts, and we'd like to see more of that as far as the other applications that make use of those kind of technology. Okay, so I'm going to jump back over to my slides since we've kind of been talking about this for a while. So this is really kind of my slides. We just talk about the same things that we just demoed. So a few other neat features that I'll talk about before we kind of move into what's coming up. So the applications can all be edited and viewed through SMB shares. So I'm going to show that real quick. Where again, if you're just using the IP address or the OWASP BWA host name, you can go to the VM and actually browse in the var www directory and actually see the code. So this is for the Mutility application that I was showing earlier. This is all the code files there. If you wanted to edit one of these files, then it'll be making changes to the code and see what happens. It also allows you to take a look at for example, that login page that we were looking at earlier. You can see the code that actually implements that some of the checks for whether or not what security level it's on, and also how it does some of the other stuff. So it's a little bit more complicated than a real application because it is a training environment. But if you're looking at one of the real applications, it can be pretty realistic, or the real applications, it can be useful for, again, developer training. We also have the ability to rebuild some of the applications. So if you you can SSH into the machine, as I mentioned briefly earlier. And if you, again, the password is just open to OWASP BWA. And let me scroll down here a little bit. So if the easiest way to know what's going on as far as what's available for scripts is just to type OWASP or OWASP BWA and hit tab, and you'll see kind of a list of different scripts that we have. So this is where we've got things to rebuild the Yazd application, to rebuild WebGoat, for example, if you go in, as I mentioned, browsing through the SMB shares to make any changes to that. And There's also some other things. This is where the mod security rules are that I'll talk about in a little bit later. But and you can do that through the console as well, but I usually just SSH in. It's a little bit easier. And also what's on here is there's a couple scripts to update the VM. So what it does is basically it'll go out, like the update all one, will go out and pull all of the applications from their respective source code repositories, which is kind of dangerous because it might break things. But it can allow you to update individual applications or in this case, all the applications without having to wait until we actually put out a new version of the VM. So it's just something to be aware of. You can also update just the OWASP BWA stuff, which is probably not terribly useful other than maybe a few applications that are not kind of available at other places that I have in our own repository. Also, we'll pull in like updates to the homepage, for example, if necessary. And I mentioned earlier, mod security is running. So these three scripts, the mod security CRS log, mod security CRS block, and mod security CRS off, will allow you to basically configure the mod security core rule set. So the disabled is kind of how it comes out of the box. But if you want to kind of turn it into a logging mode where you're just kind of seeing what does mod security catch and what does it flag, you can do that. Or you can put it into a blocking mode, which is useful if you want to know, how can I get around what mod security is doing, or at least understand what it's doing. And if you want to write your own mod security rules, that can be useful as well. You can go into the SMB shares in the right directory and mess with them. Also through the SMB shares, you can get to all your log files if you want to look at, how do these attacks look. If you're looking at like the error logs or the access logs in Apache or other things. So everything's kind of left at the default setting, which is what you'd most likely see, but you can certainly mess with it if you want by editing your Apache configuration. And also the logs are all cleared when I kind of package the VM, so that way everything you see is what you actually did. It's none of it's like stuff from by my earlier work, I guess. And Also, just to be aware, as I mentioned, I think earlier, there's a user guide available. It's kind of linked off of various places, but it actually lives on Google Code right now as a wiki page, and it really kind of walks you through a variety of a lot of the stuff we've talked about here, getting started, but also some of the more advanced features as well. So if you ever kind of want to look at how can I do some of those things that I've heard about? Look at the user guide, and if it's not there, then feel free to reach out and ask us questions. And then just real quickly, we don't have a master list of vulnerabilities on the application, so we're looking for the community to contribute those. So I'll show you briefly in a second how we have those. So we've got an issue tracker at SourceForge. So if you go on, for example, the BWA homepage. At the bottom, there's this link. And it's listed other places as well, off the user guide and other places. But you can, we're using the issue tracker because it just works best for what I wanted to try to accomplish. So what we've got is it's just kind of a list of different issues that we found in the VM. And this is where you'll see that we have the OWASP BWA hostname being used. So if you've got that set up, then you can sometimes just click directly on the links in here in order to actually exploit a particular issue on the VM. And so it's kind of broken down by component and severity in that. Anyone can submit issues. So if you don't even have to log in, you can just go click here and do a new ticket. Anyone can view the issues or look at the details for one, for example. If you click here, the summary, it'll show it to you. So trying to kind of crowdsource this as far as get other people to contribute to this. So if it's if you're someone who uses a VM and you'd like to help out a little bit, definitely putting some of this information in here would be helpful. But to be clear, what we're not trying to do is duplicate what's already done in the sense of like the training applications, usually within the application itself, include some information about where vulnerabilities are. They might have their own documentation in that as well. So we're really just trying to collect this primarily for like the open source applications and maybe some of the realistic applications that don't have good documentation already. So we're trying to not reinvent the wheel, I suppose. And this is just kind of showing what I just showed you, so we can skip through that. Okay, so really, where are we going? So in the short term, before the end of the year, I plan to release version 1.2. There's a couple minor fixes that I want to put into the VM. I've been reached out to a couple times by the people who write the BWAP application that we're going to add. And also, as I mentioned, the Mutility application is very frequently updated. They're updating, usually, every month or sometimes every week. So I want to make it a more streamlined process to actually be able to update that individual application in order to be able to use its most recent version without having to potentially try to update other things that are more likely to break. They're usually pretty good about the changes that they make. Don't usually break anything on the VM. So that's where we're going in the near term. As I mentioned, we've got a user's guide, but it always needs improvement. So if people want to help out with that, that's a great way to help, along with expanding that catalog of vulnerabilities. So really looking for people to help out in any way if they can in those areas. But in the longer term, we've got a few other things that we want to cover. So it's going to get increasingly difficult to support modern applications and the old applications that we have. If you look at the list of applications, like some of them, the open source applications, some of them were written in like 2002, so that's 11 years ago. They require kind of older versions of certain libraries and stuff. I've gotten it all to work on the VM as it is, but I'm not going to be able to update the whole OS. And I think that at some point you're going to run into newer applications not working because of these kind of conflicts in libraries and that. So at some point we may move to actually having multiple VMs where maybe OWASP BWA version 2 is a separate VM that kind of complements what's in the version 1 VM, and that you could in a lab environment or training environment kind of run them side by side. We'd also like to improve the set of applications. So that's really what the next set of slides is going to talk about. And I kind of call this my wish list because a lot of this is stuff that I don't have time to go out and write, or a lot of times the expertise to go out and write either. So the BWA project is really about assembling things that are hopefully already out there. So looking for you guys or perhaps other people to maybe create some of these or to point us to where they already exist. So they could be that some of these are out there and we just need to put them onto the VM. So next, there we go. Yep. So we mentioned we have a little bit of compiled Java, but not a whole lot, and I think that's something that would be common, better to have more of that. More ASP.NET would be good, Python, and Node.js as well. I know that there's a Node.js kind of WebGoat type project that's starting up, so it'd be nice to be able to pull that in when they get to the point of having it, but it would also be nice to have some of the kind of realistic applications or even open source Node.js applications as well. Also, more kind of libraries and frameworks. So, like the, we don't have anything that's using any of the common like PHP or Python frameworks, or even like I said, we have a very little bit of like Struts code, for example. So it'd be nice to have more of that represented, just because I think it's more realistic is what developers are actually building these days, and would be better for developer training. But I'm really looking for feedback here. So if you happen to be someone or know somebody who uses the OWASP BWA VM for any sort of developer training, let me know what you'd like to see on there, what you've done maybe to build, add some stuff yourself, and give us ideas of what to add, because we're definitely willing to accept any sort of feedback. I'd also like to have more modern UIs in the application, so rich JavaScript, HTML5, maybe some mobile optimized sites. I mean, it probably wouldn't make that much difference as far as the vulnerabilities, you would think, but it's good to have just kind of the gamut covered and have different ways to look at things. Adobe Flash would be nice to have just because you can have applications that use the Adobe's AMF format for passing data back and forth as opposed to HTTP. So that can be would be interesting to have a test bed for that for people that might want to test those sorts of apps. As I mentioned, the PostgreSQL is there. We'd like to use that, but even SQLite and other kind of NoSQL databases, it'd be nice to have some different database backends. So I really think this is a great opportunity for someone to step up and create just a little application that just has a database and does some basic queries on it, but that has SQL injection, and then just have variants of that application that, one that connects to MySQL, one that connects to Postgres, one that does SQLite, maybe another that does MongoDB or some other NoSQL kind of thing. And give you an opportunity then to people to see, okay, if I'm going to do SQL injection on that type of database, this is how I would do it, especially for the exploitation phase, because the basic SQL injection is usually relatively the same depending on, regardless of what database you're using. But when you get into more like, trying to query, what tables are available and some of the metadata as far as where users are stored and things like that, it is going to differ based on the back end. So I think that having different ones would be very useful. you know, I'd also like to improve the set of real applications. So we've got some open source applications, but they're pretty old in a lot of cases. Nice to have more of them, and it would be nice to have more modern applications. I feel like we've got a lot of the kind of training applications and the intentionally vulnerable applications. It'd be nice to have more open source applications, especially because those are the ones that are going to look like, you know, what actual code is going to look like that developers are using. More web services would also be nice, since there's not a lot there. I've been working a little bit with the people that are creating Goat Droid and iGoat, I believe, are the names of its iOS and Android versions of kind of WebGoat of vulnerable mobile applications. You know, most of the times, mobile applications are going to talk to some sort of web services backend, so it'd be nice if they could talk to the OWASP BWA VM, so that you could, even without the actual mobile client, you could talk to the web services. Just rich web UIs sometimes use web services that can be useful, and even things like desktop thick clients. So I think that would be nice to have, just because I think you're seeing more of that, especially on the mobile side. And if anyone's a designer or knows someone who is, I'd love to get some help on kind of helping improve the homepage on the VM. It's a little bit dated, needs to be a little refreshing is always good every so often. Maybe make it a little bit more intuitive as far as the layout. Also kind of considering the idea of separating out the applications or somehow highlighting them or filtering them somehow based on, you know, the scope of that application. So some of the applications are very small, others are very large and include a lot of different things. Some are very modern and updated frequently, others have not been. So it'd be nice to help, you know, kind of differentiate that. And also maybe the user's role. So maybe a developer would, you know, there'd be some way that you would be able to say to the VM, I'm a Java developer, and it would kind of highlight these are the Java applications or these are the applications where, you know, that whatever skill set you have would be most applicable. Or your level. So if like I'm a very beginning person, then maybe you can highlight the training applications. If you're someone who's more advanced, then you can look at some of the open source applications. Oh, looking for feedback from you guys on what you think that would be helpful for. So sounds like from my hand raises earlier anyway, you guys haven't used it a whole lot. But once you have, definitely give us some feedback, because I'd like to hear what you guys think about how to move forward on that. So I'm running out of time here, so I don't have time for questions right now, but definitely let us know what you would like to see in the BWA VM. We welcome any of your feedback, any broken apps you can provide. I know there's a variety of companies that have their own kind of internal, you know, training applications that they've built for some of their developer training, for example, or other things like that. If you can convince your company to donate the application to OWASP and allow us to put it on the BWA VM, that would be great for us. And it's also good for you in the sense of you can then use the BWA VM for your training. You don't need to maintain your own application and have your own kind of VM or whatever kind of setup that you need. So it allows you to kind of outsource some of that management to us. And so this is really my last slide. We welcome, like I said, any feedback. If you want to get more information, OWASP BWA is the main homepage. It'll take you to the link on the OWASP homepage. The Google group is kind of what we use for our mailing list, so that's a great place to ask questions if you ever have them. Follow us on Twitter at OWASP BWA, which primarily we just tweet about releases and occasionally, you know, presentations and things like that. Definitely submit bugs. I didn't show it, but on Google Code, we use the issue tracker on Google Code for actual like bugs in the VM. So definitely submit those if you have them, or you can send them to me or to the Google group. And then the security issues can go to issue tracker. So anything that you can do is definitely welcome. But really just want more people using the VM to see what's there, and I'd like to hear more about how people are using it and what they'd like to see. So thank you much.